Welcome to an LA Public Radio partnership of KCRW and KPCC and LAist, a series of virtual events called Meet the Candidates. It's a series of events that we're hosting from the Annenberg Performance Studio here at KCRW in Santa Monica. I'm Steve Chiotakis, host of Greater LA on KCRW. Thank you for joining us tonight. We're talking to one of the folks seeking to represent the 3rd District of the LA Board of Supervisors. It's the County Board of Supervisors, which covers a massive area. We're talking about from Malibu to Santa Monica, from West Hollywood all the way up to Porter Ranch, Calabasas, Agoura Hills, other areas of the San Fernando Valley. Primary election set for June 7th. We have a general election that is set for November 8th. These virtual events are part of coverage made possible by support from the Committee for Greater LA in partnership with the Conrad N. Hilton Foundation and the Weingart Foundation as well. We have received questions for the candidates from listeners ahead of the event, so we have those ready to go. We also invite you to ask your questions as well, and I'm going to tell you how to do that. You can share your questions throughout the conversation tonight by submitting them through the Q&A function located on the right side, so let's see, the right side of your screen, with live captioning also available. You can click the CC button on the bottom of the video. So our guest tonight is Lindsey Horvath. She is in her second stint as member of the West Hollywood City Council, appointed to the council in 2009. She served until 2011. She has been serving again since being elected to the seat in 2015. She runs her own marketing business, based in Santa Monica, I believe, focused on the entertainment industry. She was born in Painesville, Ohio, so she's a Buckeye, and she is 39 years old. Council member, welcome to you.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for coming on tonight. You have been part of the government of West Hollywood, which is, by the way, one of LA County's smaller cities, right? There are some big cities in LA County. There are smaller ones. Population, what, about 35, 36,000?
That's right.
Yeah. Before that, you were active as a political activist, though, not a politician, helping. You led the National Organization for Women, among others. How does your track record prepare you to help lead a county government and a county population of 10 million people?
Sure. So I served as mayor during COVID. I served also during that time as president of California Contract Cities Association, which is an association of independent cities in LA County, many of which contract for service with LA County, whether it's sheriff and fire, public works. And so I saw firsthand during a time of crisis where the county met the moment and where it didn't. And in addition to my work in local government, which I've been in for 15 years, I was a community organizer and activist, building diverse coalitions, taking action on the issues that matter most to people. As I was coming into my first stint on the city council, I was working to clear the backlog of untested rape kit evidence in LA County, working with then Supervisor Zev Yaroslavsky, and working with the sheriff's department to make sure the backlog was fully tested, fully funded, and then tested. And I remember when that evidence was entered into the CODIS system and the crimes that were able to be solved as a result of that information. But there's a lot of work that goes into what it takes to be a county supervisor. Some of it comes from governmental experience. Some of it comes from listening to people in the community and being able to bring diverse perspectives into your decision-making, being able to meet people where they are and be of service, and that's what I've done my whole life.
I'm listening to you now, and you said the county has met its moment, but then the county did not meet its moment in some cases. Can you expound on that?
It's no secret that there are people who were frustrated during this time of emergency. I think from a local government perspective, we would watch press conferences from the governor's office around noon. And by 5 or 6 o'clock in the evening, we were supposed to implement a health order on the ground. And as a local government, we were supposed to make sure that businesses were complying with those health orders, that they were doing everything they could to keep their workers and their customers safe, keep communities safe. And a lot of times by the time we were supposed to know what was going on, we hadn't really gotten clear direction, but we still had to do all that we needed to do at the local level to help take care of people in our community. So while we were waiting for answers from the county or from the state, we had to act. And so we didn't have the luxury of being able to wait. There were people who were looking to us to deliver for them.
For the city of West Hollywood?
Yes, local government in particular, and no matter where we were. And so in my community, we stepped up and made sure that we had at-home meal delivery for homebound seniors and older adults who couldn't be out because they were at risk of leaving their homes. We actually did a supply drive. We asked all of the businesses that did close that had PPE to share with medical and frontline responders to share those supplies. And I led that effort to actually collect those supplies and redistribute them in our community. But we also had to step up and make sure that we were, you know, doing all that we could to keep people cared for and housed. And so we did that too.
The county is huge.
It is.
It's huge geographically. Mm-hmm. It's huge demographically as well, with 10 million people and a lot of area to cover. Five supervisors representing those 10 million people. And that's more than most states, by the way. If you divvy it up, it's about 2 million per supervisor district, right?
It's about the size of the state of Ohio, in fact.
It's a pretty big county. Is it really? LA County is about the size of Ohio?
That's right.
Wow. It's a lot of territory to cover nonetheless. So do you think the Board of Supervisors, because you mentioned there was some frustration in the early days of the pandemic that you were waiting for things to come down and they didn't come. There are five people who make many of those decisions. Do you think the board should be expanded?
I'm certainly open to that. And I think that, you know, obviously that decision comes from the voters. That's something that has to be changed by the people. But it's something I would be supportive of because it would allow for more diversity in representation in the county. It would allow for more voices to be heard. Certainly five people for 10 million. That's quite a ratio. And so
it would dilute your voice, though.
For me, this is about using the power that I have to help people. And I think sharing that power to make sure that more people have their voices represented is an important thing to do. That's why we go through a redistricting process, but it's also why sometimes we have to make changes. And I'm open to that. I'm open to what is going to be the most effective way to serve people and meet them where they are. And more representation typically is the right way to go.
And by the way, District 3 was redistricted, right? It was
all of them were, yes.
Yeah, they were all. And a little more conservative, right? It's a little larger?
Yeah, to be determined. I think there's, you know, we're in LA County, so there are a lot of progressive voices. There are conservative voices. But I think more than anything, this is local government, and we have to meet people where they are and just be pragmatic rather than political.
I want to invite a community member who submitted a question to ask to the candidate. Lionel Mades, would you stand up at the microphone and ask your question? Thank you for coming, by the way.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi.
Good evening, council member. My question to you is, what are your plans to deal with the problems we're experiencing at the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department?
Wow. Well, that's a big question. And thank you for your question. It's certainly one that's top of mind for a lot of people in LA County. Certainly the Board of Supervisors has been trying to address this issue with the authority that they have. But we also need to make sure that we're holding the Sheriff's Department accountable for the work that that they're doing in community. I think people are very concerned about their safety right now, and we need to make sure that law enforcement has the resources that they need to fight violent crime. People are scared and concerned, and we need to address those fears. But we also need to make sure that the department is doing the job that we expect them to do. And I serve currently as chair of the Liability Trust Fund Claims Board and Oversight Committee, which is a mouthful, but it's also the body that deals with all of the deputy-involved incidents. So I see firsthand on a regular basis not only the dollars and cents cost to the communities that contract with the Sheriff's Department and the county itself, but also the loss of trust that happens with some of these incidents and the loss of life that can happen with some of these incidents. So we need to make sure that that we're holding the Sheriff's Department accountable. We've heard that there's willingness to reform and to change, but every state law that was proposed to make those changes, even in the wake of the murder of George Floyd, was opposed by law enforcement at the state level. And the changes that might have been made in the LA County might have been made on paper, but we've seen headline after headline of the non-compliance with those changes. So we need to make sure that we are investing in what actually keeps communities safe. Sometimes that's an unarmed security ambassador, which we employ in our community. Sometimes it's going to be investment in mental health or behavioral crisis response. We have some of those employees also in LA County, in my community, and we need to make sure that we're investing in the services that are actually going to meet the moment and keep people safe.
Thank you, Lionel. The current LA sheriff is up for re-election, by the way.
Yes.
This is Alex Villanueva. Mm-hmm. His department, of course, faces allegations of civil rights violations, misconduct, financial management, deputy gangs, allegedly,
yes,
records of clashing with the board and other county officials, including the inspector general and the Civilian Oversight Commission. So mm-hmm. how do you deal with issues should Sheriff Villanueva be re-elected?
Well, we have to work within with everyone in the department. Should Sheriff Villanueva be reelected, that would be the will of the people. And
is there a better candidate?
It's well, there might be a better candidate, and I'm prepared to work with whomever the people elect, because that's what people will expect the next supervisor to do. But we have to make sure that the department, again, is responding to what people actually need in their communities.
It doesn't sound like a resounding endorsement, though, for Alex Villanueva.
I haven't endorsed anybody.
Okay.
You know, I'm prepared to work with anyone, but
All
I do think that we need to make sure that we're doing what people expect to keep them safe and avoiding some of the misconduct, including the continued presence of deputy gangs that exist. I supported Congressmember Gomez's inquiry into that from Congress. I supported former Attorney General Javier Becerra's investigation as well. And I think that we need answers. People want accountability. They want to make sure that there's trust in law enforcement.
You said you're prepared to work with whomever it is.
That's right.
If whether Villanueva is reelected or not. But it's a fact that the city of West Hollywood contracts with the LA County Sheriff's Department.
That's part
They're
of the reason
your police
I'm prepared.
Force. Right.
That's exactly right.
But preparation. So if somebody comes to you and says, deputy gangs, financial things, misconduct, record of clashing with the board, other things, you've sort of been there.
I've been dealing with
it
already.
What have you done, and what kind of accountability have you asked for? Have you demanded?
We've called for more training. We've called for audits into the work that they're doing in my own community. We just did that as recently as last week, because we heard whistleblower claims. The problem with the contracting model that people don't always understand is you either contract with the sheriff's department and accept the level of service that they provide, or you don't. We don't have hiring and firing authority that resides with the sheriff. We don't get to implement different policies. The department implements their policies. So we can create a culture in our community, and we've actually done a pretty successful job of that in our community, working with them to focus on issues of the LGBTQ+ community, working on specialized issues that we face as a community that welcomes the entire world into our city on a regular basis. So I have experience working within the department already, but we also know that as a supervisor, I'll have a lot more authority to make some different decisions.
Have you guys thought about canceling the contract with the sheriff's department? Has that ever come up?
In our city?
Yeah.
Absolutely. That conversation is happening right now, whether we're going to do that or not. And, you know, for my part, I'm listening to everybody who has an opinion on that.
What's your opinion?
Well, I think that we need to make sure that we're actually providing the service that people are expecting. And so right now we're going through that process. We're conducting the audit to see the sheriff intends to do about the problems that we're experiencing in our community and within the department as a whole. And we're evaluating whether the cost that we're paying for that contract would be better spent elsewhere. And so we'll be going through that process.
Let's get to another audience question that we
sure.
got. Would you consider legislation to allow the sheriff to be appointed instead of elected?
Well, that decision to make the position unelected is not one that the board would decide. It would have to be decided by the people. And I would fully support that. I think that having a sheriff that has a different kind of relationship with the board, I think would help it to work better. But I would do that only if that's what the people want.
LA County has committed to a jail, I'm sorry, care first, jails last policy is what it's called.
Absolutely.
Which includes closing Men's Central downtown.
Yes, it does.
Replacing it with housing supportive services. Now activists are saying that the transition to close the jail is happening way too slowly. So a couple of questions about that.
Sure.
There are thousands of people in Men's Central with serious mental health problems. Do you support moving people with mental illness out of the jails? And if so, how would you accelerate the process of finding housing for these folks and providing services to these folks?
I absolutely do. Right now, Men's Central is simply overcrowded. It's not providing a level of service or care that that people need in that facility. We absolutely have to make sure that we're investing in the Department of Mental Health, that we're getting people into treatment in many cases. Many times people are in jail simply because they can't afford bail. And so we're creating conditions that make the problems worse, not better. We need to make sure that people are held accountable, but sometimes accountability looks like putting someone in safe housing to receive treatment and care so they aren't a repeat offender, as opposed to just putting them in a cell and hoping that their timeout does the trick. What we really need to make sure we're investing in is what's going to make a meaningful difference in people's lives. It's why I supported Measure J. It's why I support the ATI plan and fully funding the ATI plan to make sure that the right kinds of supports are invested in and taking care of community, and that we're actually helping people get out of a carceral system.
ATI?
The Alternatives to Incarceration Plan.
Thank you. I wanted you to say it, so.
Yes.
All right. We are talking with West Hollywood City Council member Lindsey Horvath, who is running for the LA County Board of Supervisors District 3. This is the seat that's being vacated by Sheila Kuehl, and I want to thank you again for coming on and talking to us as we move on with this conversation. You are one of two millennials running for this seat.
Yes.
How does that feel?
It's exciting. It's exciting. This is not a job where people should be looking to retire. There's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah.
And we need somebody who's ready to do that work, to roll up their sleeves and do the hard work that people are counting on the county to deliver.
One of the things that people are, millennials especially, are most active about is climate change.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to ask you, what are the three concrete things that you would do to address the climate crisis? I mean, you're obviously one person out of many, but what is your plan?
Well, the good news is LA County has a plan. The LA County Sustainability Plan was informed by a bottoms-up approach, making sure that we listen to voices of community throughout the district and throughout the entire county to inform how we can tackle this crisis. And I'm grateful to the leadership of Pacoima Beautiful, who really helped to lead District 3 in terms of our contribution to that plan. One way we're going to do that is by continuing to grow the Clean Power Alliance, which has been an innovation of LA County. I serve in leadership on their board and on their executive committee, and they are the new clean energy provider in our county, now the largest community choice aggregate, CCA, in the country. And that has allowed us to influence our purchasing power to make sure that the energy that is coming into our communities is cleaner and greener. And we also are building our own infrastructure, which also generates that energy and creates new green jobs. So we are putting our money where our mouth is and helping to transition off of fossil fuels into a clean energy future. We need to make sure that we make good on the promises of Measure W. Of all of the measures that have been passed recently by LA County, I think this one is the most transparently accountable. You can go to the website and see all of the localized plans, again, informed by local community on what projects need to be prioritized, where dollars need to be spent. And I think we need to deliver on the promises of Measure W and make sure, in particular, one area that I think we can improve is making sure that the education dollars that were allocated through Measure W are actually spent so people understand not only what the outcomes will be, but what their role can be in effectuating that change. And then I think we also need to look at decarbonizing not only future development, but existing development, and making sure that we're preparing to be resilient as we look at what the impacts of the climate crisis have already been and will continue to be. Obviously, we can't put everyone into new housing, so we need to make sure that existing buildings, especially existing housing, have been retrofitted and adapted to deal with the climate challenges that we're facing now. And so those are some of the big ones, but certainly I think the biggest one that the county has really taken a leadership role in is to end oil drilling in communities and to transfer away from fossil fuels and make sure that we're protecting our communities.
Alternative fuels, sunshine, solar, wind.
Those are some of the options.
Yeah. Vicki Rank is another community member who submitted a question for you. She's unable to join us in person this evening, but I wanted to make sure that we ask her question, which addresses the drought, which is, of course, is a part of climate change and what's going on with the planet. What immediate concrete steps will you take to lower water use by both county residents and the county at large?
Well, I think we need to make sure that we are recycling water, that we are that stormwater systems are actually working and delivering and being fully built out. We also need to make sure that we are working to educate consumers of that water and making sure that people are following best practices and understand the impact that their water usage has on the available supply. We need to make sure that water is coming from our region locally and making sure that I know that there are goals to that effect again in the LA County Sustainability Plan. And so those are some of the ways we can address it.
The water is not coming though local. I mean, there is a lot of water coming from other places. Colorado River, the Owens Valley, places like that, right?
Water is coming from other places, but there is water available here if we focus on transitioning to making sure our local water resources are being used.
Why do you think it's taken so long to capture stormwater in LA County?
Well, it requires extensive investment. It requires support at the local level from higher levels of government. A lot of times state mandates come down, you know, and tell us at the local level what we're supposed to do, but it doesn't come with the funding necessary to make those changes. And so very grateful to, you know, those folks in Sacramento who want to set those goals, but without the funding to do it, it's really just a lot of, you know, sort of finger wagging at us who actually have to implement solutions on the ground and deliver.
KCRW covers housing and homelessness frequently. One of the big trends has been embracing housing first. In other words, creating permanent supportive housing before you use law enforcement to move people off the streets, which we've also seen, obviously. Do you support forcibly removing encampments before there are enough housing units for people?
I don't think anybody needs to be forcibly removed. In my community, we work with street teams that go out every day of the week. We partner with social service organizations that also contract with the county. They themselves also hire formerly unhoused people. So there's a trust there and a level of experience. So when they engage in discussion with people that we're looking to serve, they're able to do so effectively. And we help people understand what resources and services are available. We transport them to mental health care or addiction recovery or housing, depending on what they're prepared for and what they need. And so I think what we've been able to do has delivered year after year, about an 80% success rate, getting people off the streets and into housing services or both. And so I think we need to do more of that and focus less on, you know, the things that take away people's rights. We need to help people understand what services and support are available. And that's why leading with care is very important.
Leading with care. But and when you look at like the things that have happened in the past in Echo Park, which happened how long has it been? A year ago, or more than a year now. Venice, we've talked about MacArthur Park, other places like that where people have been forcibly removed and where the county, or whether in this case the city of LA, has said, okay, we're putting you into housing, and yet very few people go into housing, whether it be temporary or permanent. I mean, when you look at that, how do you, what do you say to yourself? Like, if you want to become somebody who is one of the people who oversees 10 million people in LA County.
Well, we've seen the effect of that in my own community. We've seen that some of the more aggressive violent crime that has happened in our community has come from people who came from other regions and were not properly served and supported and gotten into care. Moving people around instead to declare victory isn't a victory at all, and it's certainly not helping the people who need that help the most. We need to make sure that that we're actually meeting people where they are and following them through the system and making sure that they get into housing, they get into services, and that they are supported, rather than, you know, doing a sweep, declaring victory, and not really being mindful of the consequences.
You think that's what's going on?
I do.
Doing the sweep, getting them out of there. The residents don't see homeless people anymore and they're gone.
Well, I think that they go to, they're still going to other communities, but I don't think that everybody who is who has been removed in the examples that you've identified has gone into housing, permanent supportive housing. I don't think
that's a fact. There have been reports about it. Yeah,
correct. Yeah. So yeah. They haven't gotten the treatment and care that they've needed. And so I understand the desire on the ground to respond to citizens' concerns and desire for people to see homeless encampments go away, but they are encampments where people live. And so we have to make sure that we're also taking care of those people, not just sort of saying, deal with the problem. It doesn't matter how.
Well, the key word is people, human
exactly.
beings. Yeah. The city and the county, by the way, famously don't work well together on housing people. I mean, this is something that we have reported on at our radio station and other people as well. The joint agency, LASA, has been ineffective in some ways as well. Some have called it for it to be dissolved. A county commission recently recommended that a single person, a leadership post who reports to the Board of Supervisors, actually be established. What would your approach be?
Well, I agree that I don't think LASA has delivered in the ways that that people expect or deserve, based on, you know, the fact that they've taxed themselves to create dollars through Measure H to address these problems.
And people, Triple H.
Yeah, and people haven't seen at the local level the impact of those dollars in their communities. So while I will say I think the recent decision has helped there to be more effectiveness and accountability, I've seen the Los Angeles City Council members investing some of their own local dollars in those efforts. And, you know, not surprisingly, that has created some more accountability. But I do think that instead of finger pointing, all of us treating this as the crisis that it is, creating a body that meets publicly every week and is accountable to where dollars were spent, which action was taken, and what outcomes were delivered is certainly in order. I think a body that includes at least the mayor of Los Angeles and the chair of the Board of Supervisors, that body should be meeting with at least those officials who are directly accountable to the people through their election. That's the kind of accountability that we need right now. And where people are electing these officials expecting that we're going to step up and make change for them. So we shouldn't be hiding behind bureaucrats that are appointed and don't necessarily have the authority that we do as elected officials to do that job.
Do you think it's being treated as the crisis that it is?
I think people understand that it's a crisis, and I think that people are relying on experts to help guide them through what the best solutions are. But I do think that there's more that we can do, and I understand the concerns that led to, for example, the creation of a blue ribbon commission on homelessness, but I also think that creating more bureaucracy is not the answer. What we need to be doing is eliminating those layers of bureaucracy and getting county dollars directly invested in local communities and local solutions.
Do you own or rent?
I'm a renter in rent-stabilized housing, so I feel very poignantly the concerns of my community and folks like myself who are looking at the end of the eviction moratorium and, you know, thinking what's going to happen next.
Yeah. What's going to happen next? Because mm-hmm. Yeah, we certainly don't know. The state recently extended some protections though for renters, for people who've applied for rent relief. How do you balance the interests of landlords? Because landlords are trying to, you know, they're not only trying to make it's not always big real estate development companies, right? It's mm-hmm. sometimes it's just a mom and pop who have four units and they've had it in the family for a number of years. balancing that, you know, to renters who have struggled during the pandemic?
Well, it's one of the reasons that I created a subcommittee in my council, but more importantly, was working directly with the Speaker's office while that bill that recently extended some additional protections to renters to also see it extend the application deadline. That application deadline for assistance passed at the end of March. And so the opportunity for landlords, for renters, for people to get that financial relief no longer exists if they haven't applied. Yet we know that there are people who are still unable to pay their rent because they haven't been able to get back to work as a result of COVID. And so now we've created a group of people who have no recourse because the application deadline wasn't extended. So I think that has left both renters and landlords or property owners in a precarious situation in that circumstance. We need to make sure that the resources that were allocated by the state government, we had a lot of good headlines about that, but where did the dollars actually go and who actually got them and what difference did it make? I heard stories about people applying for assistance, and because they submitted a Word doc instead of a PDF, they didn't get, they weren't considered. Their application was rejected. I mean, we have to get beyond that and make sure that the services and support that people are counting on are actually accessible, and that we're setting people up to succeed and not put people through a tough bureaucracy and still be left without help.
I want to get to some of the listener questions. Again, if you want to jot one down in the Q&A section on the right side of your screen, you can do that. But we do have quite a few questions, so would you mind maybe a little speed round?
Sure, okay.
If you don't mind. All right. Since you do not live in the San Fernando Valley, what do you know about the Santa Susana Field Laboratory? What's your source of information about it?
Well, I've been asked a lot about Santa Susana Laboratory.
Part of the district.
Yes, yeah. by folks in the district, by community groups that have supported me, who are interested in seeing what sort of environmental cleanup is going to happen there and what more aggressively the county will be doing to help improve quality of life for people who live nearby.
Has the state done enough? Obviously, nothing's really been done, right? There's been no cleanup.
Yeah, no, I don't think that enough has been done. I know that there's an effort to bring those who should be accountable to the table in terms of the dollars and cents needed to do the cleanup. But I think what we need to do is exactly sort of along the lines of what I described on homelessness, and have public meetings where people actually know what's being decided about what's going to happen in their neighborhoods, and allow people to be engaged in that discussion. Right now, people are sort of sitting and wondering what's going to happen. Same with Aliso Canyon and folks in Porter Ranch, who, through that redistricting process we talked about, those folks are now separated from Aliso Canyon. That is actually in a different district than the people in Porter Ranch. So now they have to go through another layer of bureaucracy to get results. We have to make sure that these decisions are made easier, not more difficult, and that they are transparent and people understand what's happening in their neighborhoods to keep them safe.
Let's talk about Aliso real fast.
Sure.
Governor Newsom pledged to shut it down. The SoCal gas facility, of course, had been there for decades, but instead, use of the gas storage has actually expanded. Mm-hmm. So it's not been shut down. It's expanded. It was the largest. What was it, the largest gas blowout in American history?
Terrifying.
I mean, do you support shutting it down, and why has it taken so long to do it?
Yes, I do support shutting it down, and not being at the decision-making table, I'm not sure why it has taken this long, because I think the evidence is clear. I think the people who are directly impacted are unified, and I think that we're all committed to a clean energy future, and so we need to continue to move in that direction.
We were talking about the sheriff, Villanueva. We also talk about the issues with law enforcement at writ large, whether it be a police department,
sure,
in the city of LA or at the county levels. I mentioned the sheriff's department and deputies there. What is your stance on when somebody says we need to defund the police?
Well, again, as I said earlier, we need to make sure that law enforcement has the funding they need to fight violent crime and keep communities safe. But we also need to make sure that we are investing in the services and support that people need to actually be safe as well, and make sure that we have the right kind of response for the right kind of issue. We've seen the devastating impact of defunding mental health care, since the 80s and the decades since. We've seen now the evidence on our streets. So I think what we need to do is make sure that we are investing in the right kind of response, whether it's mental health evaluation teams like we have in my community, where we lead with a clinical trained social worker who can diagnose somebody on the spot and get them into services and care and treatment rather than jailing them simply for being unhoused. Whether it's a response with behavioral crisis response and making sure that that we have people who are trained in these issues that don't show up with weapons and escalate a situation, that we're setting people up to succeed. And as I mentioned earlier, it's I've seen when law enforcement is called into a situation for which they are not uniquely trained, I've seen where that can be, very costly and have devastating impact. We need to make sure that we're meeting the moment with the right kind of services.
Thousands of county employees are under threat of losing their jobs over the employee vaccine mandate. This is another listener question. Do you support employee vaccine mandates?
We have one in my community, and we worked with our employees, all of the bargaining units, to work through all of the issues, and nobody's lost their jobs. So I'm not saying that I fully understand each and every case that the county has had to deal with, but I've been through this at the local level, and we have successfully been able to implement a vaccine requirement and make sure that people haven't lost their jobs in the process.
How can the county address increasing traffic deaths? In LA City alone, I want to double check this, but nearly 300 people died in 2021 in traffic-related incidents. I know this is an issue that you've worked on with the transportation or as transportation commissioner.
Yes.
So what does the county need to do?
Yes.
Writ large.
So in my community, I led the effort on Vision Zero in my city, and I know that that's a local government initiative that's going community by community. I know Assemblymember Friedman partnered with Mayor Garcetti on their plan in LA, in the city of LA, and we need to implement that countywide.
Vision Zero to 2025, right?
Yes, and so we need to make sure that we are implementing the changes that are required to keep people safe. I've seen it firsthand. Trying to keep bikers safe on Fountain Avenue, and making sure that we're working
across any avenue.
Yeah, well, in my community, Fountain Avenue is pretty
it's not just Fountain, yeah.
pretty famous right. for right. its issues. And so, what we have had to do, working cross jurisdictionally with the city of Los Angeles to get light synchronized and increased pedestrian safety and biker safety infrastructure in place has been very important. It's that kind of coordinated effort at the local level that's going to make that change. And so that's what the county needs to do, is work with local governments to make sure that those changes are being implemented.
Another question from the audience, how will you handle opposing views if elected to the Board of Supervisors, given that some of your fellow council members are backing one of your opponents?
Actually, I have the majority of my council, the majority of Beverly Hills Council, and a lot of local elected officials, in fact, over 100 local elected officials throughout the county and in this district who are supporting me. Disagreement is part of how we come to good decisions. I don't want to be in a room full of people who just think like me. I want to be in a room full of people who are the smartest and most expert on each of the issues that I'm going to have to deal with. And so I want to make sure that we're representing all of the different voices throughout the district and throughout the county. And sometimes that will mean working with people who have different points of view than me, and that's okay. We need to do that. And in fact, I think that's what we need more of. We need more and diverse opinions at the table. We need to bring different ways of thinking to solve problems and be pragmatic about solutions and not so ideological.
A team of rivals?
Well, in some cases, yes. I mean, there are going to be decisions that I'll have to make that, I'm going to be in a room full of people who might not agree with my point of view, but it doesn't mean that we can't bring people together. I was endorsed by the mayor of Palmdale and the mayor of Compton on the same day. So those two, if I can bring those two community leaders together and engage their trust and have their trust that I'm going to be the person who can deliver solutions, I think we can work to bridge, all throughout the district and throughout the county.
There's a lot of overlap, right? I mean, the mayor, like the mayors of Compton and Palmdale, what you do in the district, right, is overlapped with what those respective cities do as well.
How do you mean?
If there is, you know, like city, maybe the services are not the same, but there is overlap where the county comes in where the city leaves off.
Perhaps. I mean, some cities rely much more heavily on the county than others. Sometimes people contract for the sheriff's department. Some contract with fire. Some rely on use them for public works. There are different services that people can count on the county for. The county is supposed to be the social safety net for all of our communities.
Right.
And so in that way, we might all be the same, although I would say, you know, communities like mine, like Santa Monica, you know, other communities that have stepped up and had to invest in the social safety net because there's need there that wasn't being met. You know, communities have stepped up and done different things.
Young people are increasingly being priced out of LA. We've talked about that. Mm-hmm. Home ownership is at an all-time high. Do rent control laws need to be updated to reflect this new normal?
Well, I would love to see us overturn Costa Hawkins, fight Ellis, and make sure that we're actually protecting renters and keeping them in the housing that they can afford.
The Ellis Act is the carve-out, right?
The Ellis Act says that landlords or property owners are allowed to go out of the rental business.
Right.
But really what ends up happening is people just end up getting displaced from housing that they could otherwise afford and can't find housing that they would afford. Or that they can afford in today's market. And that contributes significantly to the housing and homelessness crisis that we're seeing. What we need to do, yes, I would love to see reform, you know, in my community, because we implemented a rent stabilization law early on. Only properties up until, I believe it's 1979, are allowed to be considered for rent control or rent stabilization. You know, in Beverly Hills, they just passed a law, and so their properties up to the mid-90s are eligible. We need to make sure that we're leveling the playing field, making sure that more properties are eligible for rent stabilization, which helps to deal with the rising costs of living, and in particular in housing. But we also need to make sure that we're increasing the housing supply and making sure that there's housing that's available for everybody. In my community, we have an inclusionary housing policy that requires at least 20% of our housing be made available for those of moderate, low, and very low income. And so that makes sure we are creating housing for everybody. So we need to do both.
Getting back to the county and unincorporated areas, what do you see as the major issues facing communities such as Topanga, unincorporated areas, and how would you address them?
Well, I think there are a lot of concerns about what sort of land use decisions the county is going to make, and how, in particular, we're protecting you know, the environment, that we're protecting our wildlife, and we're making sure that we're not building into areas that will create fire safety hazards. We need to make sure that we're appropriately using the county's land use authority to protect our wildlife and to protect our open spaces, and make sure that you know, we're continuing to protect the quality of life of those neighborhoods.
What's your top priority? You say when. You're in, right?
Yes.
You become District 3 supervisor in LA County. What's the first thing you want to tackle?
Homelessness. It's what everybody's talking about, and everybody's expecting solutions, and that's what I'm prepared to deliver. It's why I'm running. I have a record of delivering on making sure that people get off the streets into housing, services, and care. And I think everybody would love to see an 80% success rate throughout the county. Admittedly, it's not 100%, but I do think that our success rate, our model, which is scalable because we're working with agencies that already contract with the county, we're dealing with the sheriff's department. You know, we are modeling what is possible for the rest of the county.
The dynamics are different, though, between West Hollywood and District 3 of LA County, right?
Well, in what sense? I mean,
well,
we're part of District 3. We are often a laboratory and an incubator for new ideas. It's not unusual for, you know, officials in Los Angeles to make a bold headline on something that we've done 6 months or a year prior. A lot of times people are looking to West Hollywood for answers to their most pressing solutions, and I'm prepared to deliver them for the benefit of all LA County residents.
I want to thank you for coming on and joining us for this conversation. West Hollywood City Councilwoman Lindsey Horvath, she's running for the LA County Board of Supervisors, District 3. This is the seat being vacated by Sheila Kuehl. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
All right. On Thursday, not tomorrow, but on Thursday, we'll be back with a talk with another candidate. This is State Senator Bob Hertzberg. I hope you'll join us then. I want to thank you for joining us tonight on this special LA Public Radio Partnership, KCRW and KPCC LAist. I'm Steve Chiotakis. These virtual events, part of coverage made possible by support from the Committee for Greater LA in partnership with the Conrad N. Hilton Foundation and the Weingart Foundation. For all of us here, have a good night.